I just want to quickly introduce myself. My name is Christine. I am an LA fellow. So I'm currently working with the LA cohort or LA immersive program as an engineering fellow to current residents. I have no technical background before I came to Codesmith. I was doing a little bit of mental health work. I did social work prior to this. And then during the peak of COVID, I realized that maybe this wasn't my calling. And I dabbled a little bit in code here and there beforehand. And I realized maybe this might be something worth exploring. And so now here I am. So tonight, as you see on our screen, we're just going to go over objects. We're going to go over functions, how they work, how to build them, objects, what is an object, what is inside of an object. And we're also going to touch on an execution context. So for those of you that are unfamiliar with it, don't worry. These are just a bunch of words that will have meaning as we go through tonight's workshop. All right. So let's go over the principles of JavaScript. So here in our easy parts, we start with a set of our fundamental principles. What is JavaScript? What are we looking forward to with it? And how do we use JavaScript right now? Okay. So JavaScript is a tool we use to write instructions to tell our web browser what to do. So if we can think of an example, let's think of like our bodies, right? So our bodies, we have our bones, and our bones would be like the HTML of it, right? Our HTML of our website, our HTML of our body. We have our CSS, which would be like, what is on our body? Like, how do we look? What is our hair color? What is our skin color? Where are our eyes placed, right? And then underneath that, we have JavaScript that adds the functionality to our body. So JavaScript could be thought of like the muscles. What are we doing with our muscles? How are we moving our arms? How are we moving our legs? Our eyes are moving around which way? So that's kind of like a very high level kind of example of how JavaScript works. It's just what we do. It's like the functionality behind everything, right? So if we go to a website and we click a button, that button redirects us to another page. And that redirection is handled by the JavaScript that we write for it. All right, thumbs on that so far? Awesome. All right, so let's hop right into it. Thank you. Let's hop right into it. So here we have something called the global execution context. So what is this? The global execution context is basically this giant thing that just contains all the JavaScript that we are writing, right? So in this little code snippet we have right here, this is contained in our global execution context, right? So this just holds everything. And then underneath it, we have something called our global memory. So our global memory is holding on to the data. It's remembering this data if we were to need to reference it later on, right? So the way JavaScript works is similar to reading a book. So when we work through JavaScript, it handles everything in a single thread execution. So it handles everything one at a time, one line by line by line. So we're not going to do anything backwards, sideways, or whatever. It reads from left to right, top to bottom. Okay, so let's walk through this together. I will go ahead and take a lucky volunteer, and we're going to figure out what is happening here in our code snippet. Does anyone want to take a stab at it? Awesome. Yeah, let's go for it.
Okay, so we basically are assigning an array to a constant variable called migrates, which essentially means that we're not planning on changing the array migrates too much or muting it in any way. So I'm still trying to grasp.
Yeah, go ahead. How do we know that we're not changing it?
Well, I mean, because it's a constant. C-O-N-S-T.
There we go. Awesome.
And then we are going to assign a variable that we do change because it has L-E-T next to it called let. And that sum, it currently equals zero. It's worth noting that the semicolon is not going to change the way the code is run, but it is a best coding practice. So that is a habit worth getting into, but I'm guilty of forgetting. And then we have some getting changed directly below that. So sum is going to now equal my grades, which is my grades at the index of 0 plus my grades at the index of 1 plus my grades at the index of 2. So the index of 0 is 50, the index of 1 is 75, and the index of 2, as most can guess, is 100. Then we are assigning a new variable, which is also mutable, called average. We know that because it's let. And that is equal to the variable sum divided by my.
Oh, you cut out.
It did first, but that's just basically the length of my grades.
Awesome. All right. So let's pause and rewind here. That was wonderful. Awesome, awesome stuff. So we have here on the very first line, we are using this keyword referred to as const. Go and circle it. So const here is a keyword that we use to declare any variable that we do not plan on changing. So in this case, we are setting a variable of an array to a value that we're not going to change. And I'll get into that in just a second. And then underneath that, we have something called the let keyword, which is another keyword we use to declare a variable. But in this case, let allows us to change the value of that variable. So if we were to declare, let's say, sum with the const keyword, we would not be able to change the value of sum because we would be using const over sum, and we just can't reassign that. Const, when you think of it, you could think of the word constant. So here we have our sum set to 0, and we are changing the value of it. We are reassigning the value of sum to be now grades at the 0th index. So we have our my grades of 50, 75, and 100, right? So naturally, we want to think that 50 is 1, 75 is 2, and 100 is 3. But in this case, in an array, that's not necessarily true. We are looking at certain indexes in our array, right? So in our array, our index will always start at 0, okay? So 50 is the 0th index, 75 is the first, and 100 is the second, okay? So when we're reassigning sum, we're adding 50, 75, and 100. And I'm not the best at math, but I believe this is 225. Right, so sum is now set to 225 based on the keyword that we used of let, because we could reassign it that way. Okay, and then underneath we have the let keyword, once again defining a variable average, and we're setting it to the evaluated result of sum, which is 225, and we know that, 225 divided by something called my grades dot length. Okay, so as we know, my grades is in reference to this array right here. This dot length that we have written, that is what we call a property. So length is a property that we can use on any array. As long as it's an array, we can use this length property. In this case, the length right here is measuring how long this array is. How many elements live in here? How many indexes, but how many elements do we have in here? So in this case, we have 1, 2, and 3. We have 3 elements that live in it. So our length of the array is 3. So in this case, we have 225 over 3. And this is very embarrassing because I'm not very good at math. If we divide it, our average is set to 75. Okay. Thumbs on that so far. Does this make sense? Or I can definitely go over this. We could walk through it one more time, line by line. Okay. Thumbs. All right.
One more time.
Yeah, of course. Of course. So let me go ahead and clean this up a little bit. Go ahead.
Before you go over it again, can I ask a quick question?
Yeah, of course.
So the const my grades, you can actually arrays and objects are mutable, so you can actually change it. But what is permanent about it is its reference point in memory. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Yes. Thank you. So here, I said I was going to come back to it, but I didn't, but that was a very good point. Yes. So we can assign, or we can create our variable. We can create our array and our object using the const keyword, because we're not actually going to change the array or the object. We're just adding or removing elements from it, adding or removing properties from it, key value pairs, if you will. But it's still going to stay an array. It's still going to stay an object. We're just changing what's inside of it. Okay. So to walk through it one more time, so we are declaring a variable myGrades with the const keyword at the top. And again, we're using const because we're not going to change this array itself. We're simply just going to be adding or removing values from it. So we're declaring a variable myGrades with an array with these values of 50, 75, and 100. And as an array, when we look at an array, these are indexes, right? So we have the zeroth index, the first index, and the second index. If we wanted to add more, if we wanted to say, let's change this back to blue, if we add 125, this would be our third index, okay? But that's not what we're declaring here. I just wanted to highlight or emphasize that for everyone. Okay, so we're declaring a myGrades array there. And underneath that, we're declaring another variable with a label sum, and we're assigning it the value of 0. Okay, now that value, this one can be changed because of the keyword that we're using, let. Okay, so underneath that, we have our sum right here, and we're reassigning its value based on how we're writing it, right? So here we're assigning it the value of 0. And then underneath it, we are reassigning it based on what we have on the other side of our equal sign. So we're going to say sum is now going to be myGrades at the zeroth index, which in this case is 50, plus myGrades at the first index, which is 75, and myGrades at the second index, which is 100, right? So sum will now actually be 225. All right, thumbs if we're following on that so far. Okay, beautiful. So underneath that sum, so now that we have sum assigned to a new value, we're going to have another variable declared right here, again with the let keyword. And we're declaring a variable average, and we're assigning it the value of sum, which we know is 225, and we are dividing it by myGrades.length. And again, the length right here is simply a property that we can use on our array. There's other properties out there. You're more than welcome to look them up on MDN. There's a ton of them out there. But the length property in this case right here is just checking to see how long this array is. So the index might be a little confusing, but it's just to let you know, like this length is just wants to see how big this array is. And in this case, the array only has three things in there. That was 50, 75, and 100. Okay, so now we are dividing 225 by 3, which in this case is 75. So now we know average is actually just gonna be 75. Let me move that closer. All right, thumbs on that? Awesome, okay, great. So I'm gonna go ahead and move on over to the next slide. So again, it's just to let you know, this is what happens when JavaScript code runs. It goes through it line by line, like we went through. It'll see this, and it'll read this, and it will add myGrades to the global memory. And then it'll see sum, and it'll add it to the global memory. So what it does is it saves this data that we have, these variables. It could be numbers, words, lists, with a label right here. So sum and myGrades are the labels. And then it'll change or save or whatever the data that we have by referring back to its label. So like I said, we are manipulating sum here. We are changing the value of sum because we know that for one, it exists. And two, we have something happening on the other side of this equal sign that will reassign it, that will change the value of it. Okay, thumbs on that so far? Awesome, do we have any questions before I move on?
I think you have a question in the chat.
Oh, I do. Sorry. Let me go and check that right now. As I understand, it's just a constant. Variables can be changed, but it's not changing. Yes. Yes. That's very true. Lena, do you mind reiterating what the clarification was? I don't remember what the clarification was, but I will just say again, just to highlight these keywords, we have our const and let, which are keywords that we use to define our variables. Const, again, is to declare a constant variable, one that we know is not going to change. In this case, we can declare our array with the const because we're not going to actually change this array. We're just manipulating what's inside of the array. And then we have our let keyword, which lets us change the value of whatever it is assigned to. Okay?
So quick question then to follow up to that. So you're saying that by declaring my grades as a constant variable, you're keeping it as an array, like that's going to be its identity, but can you add, like push more elements or like?
Definitely, yes.
Okay.
You definitely can. So if I wanted to, and this might be a bit more advanced, so if this doesn't make sense right now, don't worry about it. But if I wanted to, I can write my grades dot push, which is another property or method. I'm sorry. It's a method we can use on our array, and we can push 125 on there. So now when we want to look at my grades, it will look like this, 50, 75, 100, and 125. Because we push something on there. So my grades would again still be the same because it's still an array, hence the const keyword, but we're just manipulating what goes in it. Okay? But that's a great question. Any other question?
Yes. Yeah. You just mentioned the push. I know it's out of context, but the push, regardless if it's less than, regardless of the number, it always goes, you know, at the back. It's always going to be the last number.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's correct. Awesome. All right. So for those of you that are still new to this, don't worry about it. It will come with practice to you. Let's go ahead and move on. So here we are looking at what we now have is a function. Okay. I'm going to try and slow it down a little bit because this part might get a little tricky. There's a lot to go over here. So we're just going to look at the code first. And as we look at it, we're going to walk through it, talk through it, and then we're going to walk through it again. And we're going to diagram at the same time. Okay. So here we have our function. Let's see, does anyone want to volunteer to walk through this line by line with us?
Okay. I can give it a shot.
Okay, awesome, thank you.
Okay, so I don't know what the exact technical communication is, so.
No worries.
You're gonna correct me if I go astray.
You're gonna do great, let's go through it.
Okay. So starting off, we have a function and we've named it average grade. And this function currently does not have any parameters.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an anonymous function because we do have a name for it, average grade, which means it can be called later.
Mm-hmm.
So within this function, first we declare a constant variable named myGrades, and we assign it to the array with elements 50, 75, 100.
Right.
And as a result, it's not in global memory, correct? Because it's within the function itself.
That is correct.
Okay. And then going on to the next line, we declare a let variable called sum, and we assign it the numerical value 0.
Mm-hmm.
Again, it's not in global memory.
Mm-hmm.
Going to the next line, we reassign sum by setting it equal to my grades index 0, which we know from our array is the value 50,
mm-hmm.
plus my grades array 1, which we know is 75. So the sum would equal 50 plus 75, which is 125.
Awesome. And we're also adding another one at the bottom of my grades index. No worries here.
And then we add the my grades at the second index. So that's 125, so that's 225. However, this number is not console logged here so far. So we just, within the function, it remembers the sum value.
Mm-hmm.
And in the next line, we declare a variable let. We declare the let variable and assign it. Declare the let variable. We name it average, and we assign it equal to the variable sum divided by my grades.length, which we know is 3.
Lovely.
And then finally, we return average value, which means that if we were to call the average grade function, that average variable, the value associated with it or assigned to it is what we would get back.
Beautiful. Then,
Oh, do you want me to keep going?
But before we go, I just want to pause. First of all, great job for walking through that. It was really difficult. Great job. So what Pinsy just read over is called the function definition. So this is what is inside our function. So a function would be like instructions, basically. These are instructions that live inside our average grade. Okay. So what we went over was just everything that will occur, everything that will happen once we call this function, once we invoke it. And whether or not we invoke it right now, later on, anywhere further down in our code, this is what will happen in this specific order. Okay. Awesome. All right. So Pinsy, if you could go on and just read the next line for us.
Sure. We declare the constant variable output, which is assigned the function name. So I believe in this case, we haven't invoked it yet, correct? We just assigned it to the variable name output. Is that true?
We are actually going to invoke it based on these parentheses right here.
Ah, gotcha. Okay. So we've invoked the function and we've assigned it a name output. And then it looks like we've invoked the function again and assigned it the variable, constant variable name, new output.
Yes, that is correct. So let me go ahead and put that down there. Oh, I didn't write enough space for myself. Okay, so what happened here? Let me go back to this. What we're doing here right now, or let's go here. So we have our function definition of average grade. This right here is again just instructions, but that does not mean we're going to invoke it. That does not mean that we're going to run it right away. That just means that this now exists in our global memory, which I should make room for. Let me see if I could cut everything, move it a little. Nope. Let me try and move this further down for everyone. So what this means again is that just this here exists, but we're not invoking it. So what we have in our global memory is, and I'm just gonna shorthand it, average grade. And how we write it is like this, meaning that it is a function that lives in our global memory. So technically we could have just skipped right over that. We didn't have to walk through that right now, but we did because we wanna know what lives inside of it. So the way JavaScript works is that because it's not invoked, it just sees, okay, this lives here, great. Let's go on down to the next one. And here we have output, which is the invocation of this function. And we know it's invoked because of these parentheses at the end. So now JavaScript's like, oh, okay, so we are going to assign the value of whatever average grade will give us, we're gonna give that to output. So as of right now, even though it's gonna be the invocation of that, output will still be undefined until we have something returned from it, okay? So let me write that in red, undefined, okay. So what happens next is that once it gets invoked, we do something to our call stack. So this call stack that we see on the side is something that contains, it's like our thread of execution, basically. Our thread of execution is how JavaScript will execute itself as it goes through the code, as it goes through its script. So our call stack will now have something called average grade popped onto it. So to add something to the call stack means you're going to pop onto it. And then, push onto, not pop, push onto the call stack, right? So when we push it onto the call stack, that means we're going to, in our global execution context, we're going to open something called a local execution context. So I'm going to shorthand it and call it LEC, But essentially, it's the same thing as here, but the L now stands for local. And as we open this local execution context, we're also going to have something called local memory, right? So like our global memory, it holds data. Our local memory will also hold data, okay? But one thing to note is our global will not have access to this local, okay? Our local app, yeah, it does not have access to each other. There are different execution contexts, okay? So as Pinzi mentioned, there are some things that we have declared in our function inside of our local execution context. And what they are, if I can make my pen tinier, is we have is the myGrades again. And our myGrades has the array of 50, 75, and 100. We also have something called our sum, which we know is 0. And that is what we have declared so far in our memory. So what JavaScript is doing is it's scanning through it, it's adding whatever it needs to be added to the local memory, and it'll execute that way, right? So next we see that sum is going to be reassigned based on what we have right here. So similar to what we did earlier, we're gonna see that sum will now be 50 plus 75 plus 100. And again, we know this because it's asking for myGrades at the zeroth index, which right here is 50, myGrades at the first index, which is 75, and myGrades at the second index, which is 100. So now we know that sum is 225, right? So we can reassign it here, 225. Next, in our local memory, we will have something called the average, we have a variable named average, okay? And our average is now set to our sum, which is 225, divided by our grades.length, which we know is 3. And our average will now be 75, right? Thumbs on that so far? Yeah, it's pretty redundant to what we saw before, but this is just in a different context now. So Okay, so what happens here is that we have something called a return keyword. So this return keyword right here, what it does is that it takes the value of whatever it's returning and it will be given to whatever we are assigning it to. So in this case, what we're doing here is we are returning, returning this average right here, this value of average, and we're going to assign it to our output, okay? So now our output is no longer undefined, but our output is now 75. Make that bigger. Okay, and that happens because we have the return keyword placed there. Thumbs on that so far. Does that make sense? Do we have any questions before we move on? Let me read the chat. Can a local execution context also refer to control structures such as conditions, loops, and error handling structures? By control structures, I'm assuming you mean just like other contexts that we'd be working in. So if we had a for loop that we wanted to work in, would we still have a local execution context? And yes, we would. Yes, but great question. Yes. All right, so that is what we get as our output. That is what output is now set to in our global memory, right? So now that we're finished with our entire thread right here, with whatever lives in this definition, now that we're done with it, we have this return keyword that highlights that it's done. This return gives us a value and it ends our function. It ends that. What we do next is we do something called garbage collecting, right? So as soon as it's done executing, we pop this frame off the call stack. And sorry, just wanna make that clear. Okay, so we pop that frame off the call stack and we do something called garbage collecting, meaning it gets removed from the memory of JavaScript. This no longer exists, this no longer happened, it doesn't have any recollection of this happening ever. So it's garbage collected, okay? Go ahead and erase that. And then, oops. Okay. And that happens, and that's fine. It got garbage collected. We don't need it anymore. So now we have this new line called new output, which is again the same invocation of average grade, which in this case we can walk through one more time, but let's have someone else volunteer and walk us through this thread of execution. Walk us through the diagramming a little bit. Does anyone want to give it a shot? Yeah, let's go for it. Let's see.
Okay.
Yeah.
So since we are invoking the function average grade,
what are we doing to our call stack once we see that invocation happen?
We're pushing on the average grade frame on top of the global
frame.
And then that opens up a local execution context.
Beautiful, right?
And then if there was a parameter, you would, what is it, pair the parameter with the argument, but there is none specified. So you move on to the next line and you declare the const variable labeled my grades into the local memory and assign it an array with the elements 50, 75, and 100.
Okay, okay.
And then you declare the next variable, a let variable, called labeled sum, and equate it to zero, or assign it the value of zero. And then within the local execution context now, you would reassign the value of sum to the sum of my grades at index zero, my grades at index one, and my grades index two, which is 50 plus 75 plus 100, which sums up to be 125.
That's 225, right?
Oh, I mean 225.
No worries.
And then we go on to the next line of code, declare the let variable labeled average. And for now it's undefined until we calculate it in the local execution context by doing 225 divided by my grades.length, which is 3, since there's only 3 elements in my grades, which is 75.
Yes.
As it's written very large in red.
I have to remember that too. I wrote it red on purpose.
Right. And then the return key indicates that we now return that value of average, which is the invocation of average grade, out into new output. And then that also means that the local execution context becomes eligible for garbage collection, and we pop off the average grade frame from the call stack.
Awesome. Awesome job. Yes. So that was wonderful. Great job volunteering with that. I can't erase this right now. Let me try and erase this a little better. Oh, well, I'll just lose my lines. But yes, that's exactly what happened. So great job in working through that. Any questions on that so far? Do we feel a little more comfortable with functions, execution context, and all this stuff? Awesome. All right. So one thing I want to point out here. Oh, before I move on, let's see what's going on in the chat. Yes. Great job, Lena. Great job. So before we move on, I want to point out here that we see that output and new output both have the same values here, right? We see that average grade was always going to give us 75. And we see that because we already have these grades defined for us that live inside the function. What happens if we want to actually make this a little more reusable for us? How do we make this more dynamic for us? Right? So we can begin to explore that if we want to use this code again and again, right? What we can do here is we can actually, does it say on the slide? Maybe I could move on. What we want to do here, we went over the keyword. We did. We went over keywords, right? Yes, we did. So what we want to do here basically to make it more reusable for us is we want to change how we use this code by not maybe having my grades directly written in it, right? Maybe we could do something by passing in something to our my grades function or average grade function. Okay, so what we see here, which Lena mentioned earlier, and I think Kinsey might have too, is we have something called a parameter at the top. So this is our parameter. This parameter you could think of as like a placeholder, right? This parameter could be literally named anything. If I wanted to, I could have named this like burgers or food. And if you follow, I might be a little hungry, but we can name it literally anything we wanted to. That does not actually affect the functionality of it. It's just the name, our placeholder that we have passed in. How we use this is we pass in arguments in our invocation, okay? So this right here, this is our argument. This is what we want to actually pass in to our function. And what it does in our function is it says, oh, there's an argument. We're gonna pair that argument with this parameter we have, and we're gonna see how we're gonna make it work, basically, right? We're gonna pair what we need to, and if we need to, then we can match things up, and so on and so forth. Thumbs on that so far? Do parameters and arguments make sense? I wanna highlight very quickly, a parameter is the placeholder. So this is the parameter, and our argument is what we're actually passing in. So this is the argument. They are not interchangeable. These are not interchangeable words. They can seem interchangeable, but they have different meanings. They serve different purposes for us, okay? So at the bottom, I'm not sure if you guys have read this, but it says, what rule is our function no longer breaking? So back here, we were breaking something called the dry principle, which means do not repeat yourself. But in this case, with our newly written function, with our parameters, with our arguments, we are no longer breaking that dry principle. We can reuse this. We don't have to repeat ourselves over and over again. All right, so let us do some diagramming together. Does anyone want to volunteer to go over this diagram? No worries, it's okay. We don't have to do a volunteer. I'll just walk us through it. It's fine. Oh, did you want to walk through it, Eli?
I can walk through it, but of course I know there are other people, so I wanted to make sure other people had an opportunity before I would just jump in, but I can do it. Basically now we have a function and average grade is being assigned that name. I don't know that because function is, as I understand it, a keyword.
Okay, and hold on. Where does this live? Does this live in our global memory or global execution context?
It's in our global execution context.
It's in our global memory. Uh-huh.
Yeah, global memory, exactly. All right, and then we have in the parentheses is where we assign a parameter, which in this case we decided to name my grades, but we can name it anything, including the food that some people might want to eat right now. And then we have the curly brackets, which basically will tell us what the function is actually going to do. And it also tells us that we are leaving the global execution context and going into the local execution context. We're not going there yet because it was not called yet, but we're telling you what's going to happen in the local execution context if we ever decide to go there. Just being clear on that. And we are then going to use let to name a variable called sum, which is assigned to zero.
Before we move on, this is great. Have we invoked this function yet, though? Have we called
it? No, we have not. Awesome. We have not called it yet. I'm just, I thought I said that earlier, but
yes, you did. That's totally fine. But so because
we have not called it yet.
Yes, because we have not invoked it yet, we don't necessarily have to walk through the definition yet.
Oh, okay. Oh, no problem. Yeah. Okay. So we just kind of skip all of that then.
Right. Right.
And then we have output, and we have a constant being assigned average grade, which being assigned to the calling of the average grade function.
Right.
Which now we have an argument passed in there. The argument's a little familiar, I think. That's 50, 75, 100 in an array.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and now, okay, we go back up to my grade, mm-hmm. which is the, we are now in the local execution context because average grade was called.
Yes, pause. So he's doing a wonderful job. Thank you so much, Eli. And we will continue in a second, but
yeah.
as we see on our next line of output, it is the invocation of average grade with our argument of my grades passed in of 50, 75, 100, right? So since yeah. it's being passed in, it's being invoked, we are pushing onto our call stack. We're pushing average grade onto our call stack as you see me write it in. And now we can enter our execution context because we are in that thread in our local execution. So continue.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Great. As Christine pointed out, we're pushing average grade into the call stack. And we are assigning a local execution context variable mm-hmm. Called sum using let equal to 0. And we have a semicolon after that because that's just good coding practice. And then we are assigning sum to equal my grades at index 0. And mm-hmm. as we see, my grades is the parameter.
Mm-hmm.
And the parameter and the what was pushed into that parameter was an array. And at index 0 of that array is 50.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go on to adding another my grades at index 1, which in this case is 75, plus my grades at index number 2, which is at 100.
Awesome. So pause.
And then
let's pause there first. But thank you so much. You're walking through us wonderfully, wonderfully. All right. So as we open this execution context, we have an argument and a parameter passed in, right? So what we want to do before we continue on is we want to pair our argument and our parameter together. So since these both exist, these are automatically added to our local memory. So technically, I mean, it is correct. What you're doing is completely correct. I'm going to move this down just a little bit. So what happens first is our local memory now immediately has this array of elements passed in our local memory. So we have access to 50, 75, and 100. Okay.
So can I clarify something too? So
yeah.
If we are in our local memory,
mm-hmm.
Would that mean then we technically also have a variable called my grade in the local execution context? Is that something that could be written in that part?
Yes, this would be the my grades here. And I should probably label that better. Sorry. Let me label that more. That way it's a little less confusing.
But that could go under the LEC column, couldn't it? My grade? Or is that
this would be in local memory.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. And do you mind if I ask the difference between local memory and then local execution context? Because obviously we're saying that they're not in there.
The local memory is what holds all of this data and information. The local execution context is like the environment that we're in.
Okay.
So the local execution context will be like where the functionality actually occurs, where everything executes. And then the local memory has all the data that we could use for our local execution context.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I can think of it more like the local brain and then like the place where things are happening, the state. So do you mind if I continue?
Yes.
Okay. So then we have a new local variable
mm-hmm.
Using let called average, which we are making equal to sum, the local variable above it. And we're using the slash, which is a division symbol, divided by my grades dot length. And that just means we are counting the number of elements in my grades in local memory, which in this case is 3. So we have the sum of 225 divided by 3, which is 75. And that is being assigned to a variable called average. And now return is telling us that we are going to leave the LEC.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. So we are garbage collecting the LEC. Mm-hmm.
So now 75 is brought back out to output, the constant variable. Mm-hmm. And now the call stack does a little bit of garbage collection after the 75 is assigned to output. And we remove all the local memory, remove everything that happened inside the function average grade.
Mm-hmm.
We then remove average grade from the call stack, and we are now back into the global execution context.
Lovely. Yes.
And then we have another line going on here. We have a constant called new output. Mm-hmm. And this time we are again invoking the, correct me if I'm not using some language correctly here, but I think now, as you're telling, we're invoking the function average grade, which mm-hmm. now brings us back into the local execution context with a different set of values being pushed into local memory, into a variable in local memory called my grade. And that values are stored in a data structure called an array,
mm-hmm.
Which is 100 and then 85 and then 100. And now we are going to basically reuse all of this code that we just wrote. And we are going to kind of repeat that again. I could go through it again if that might be helpful. Okay.
Before we go on though, does anyone have any questions before we move on as to how we got to this point again? I'm sorry, what was that?
No question, but I just want to confirm something.
Yeah.
So it looks like every time you initiate a function or you invoke a function, it gets pushed to the call stack. Is that true?
Yes, that is true. That is true. And then before I move on, I just want to, I should have highlighted this earlier. So our call stack, as you see, kind of executes in a whatever's on top. We'll go on top first and we'll do that. And then we'll move our way down. So if we had something else on the call stack, if we had something called, we'll just call it function, right? If we had another function on top of the call stack, we would actually want to execute this first, and then we do average grade. The way the call stack works is in a, it's kind of like a stack of pancakes, right? So we have our stack of pancakes. We take the pancake that's at the very top and want to eat that first. We can't just, we can't just eat at the middle. We can't eat at the very bottom. We work our way from top to bottom. So the call stack works in that similar fashion. Okay. But that's just a side note. Just wanted to highlight that for everyone. That's how that works. But yes, as soon as you invoke it, it gets added to the call stack and we open this whole new thread.
If I'm correct here, each layer of this pancake here, I think that's called I was hearing the term frame being used for.
Yes.
So is there any other good word for that, or is frame just the best word for that calling it?
I usually reference it as a frame. I don't know if there are any other terms for it, but it's a frame that you pop on and or push on and you pop off.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, great. That's okay. So it's a frame. Mm-hmm. So now we're back in the local execution context again. Mm-hmm. We have our local memory up here so far. So we now have sum equal to 0. So now that's in our local memory. Sum's doing something. Mm-hmm. And now we're going back to, now we're reassigning sum a new value, which is my grade at index 0, which at index 0 is 100. Mm-hmm. And we are adding my grade at index 1. Which in this case is 85. Mm-hmm. And then we are adding another my grade at index 2, which is 100. That's the last number in the array. And then now we have some stored in there, which in this case, is 285.
Beautiful.
That number is assigned to it. And now we're going to assign another variable to local memory. And this variable is being set equal to sum, which we now know is 285. We are dividing it by mygrades.length. And that means we're going to count the number of elements in my grades. So we have 1, 2, and 3 elements in my grades in local memory. So we are dividing 285 by 3, and 285 divided by 3. Let me see, I'm trying to do my math here. So we have a 9, and then we have a 5. So that means the average is 95, which is now being assigned to average. Awesome. And now we're going to return, and we are returning a variable called average, which is 95. And now we are leaving our local execution context with 95, which now goes down to the global execution context, which in the global execution context at this time is new output. And now we are doing some garbage collection, removing average grade from the call stack. And we now know that new output in global memory is 95.
Awesome.
Which is a constant.
Awesome job. Thank you so much, Eli. That was wonderful. Wonderful. So are there any questions on this so far? Before we move on, if I could just get a virtual thumb if you're there. And again, just to reiterate, this return keyword is our indicator that we are exiting the function and we're returning this value of average, whatever that was, to this to the variable that we're assigning it to. So as if we wanted to read this one more time, we have our variable new output, which is the evaluated result of average grade with whatever array we're passing in. So the evaluated result in this case would be 95. Okay, so I'm gonna go and move on to the next slide if we're all good. So now let's talk about something called the console log. Okay, so the console log works a little differently than the return keyword. So the return keyword provides us information. It gives the function, it provides us information from the function and it gives a value to whatever it might be assigned to. Whereas our console log will just print whatever value we're looking at onto our console, okay? It's not an actual returned value, it just shows up on the terminal, it shows up on whatever we're using, but it's not an actual returned value. So if we look at the next slide together, I have something called the console right there, and we have our global execution context and our global memory once more. All right, so I'm gonna walk us through this very quickly. So here we have in our global memory, something called add func, right? And we know this because we're looking at this line right here. It's a function definition of add func. And it is not invoked. So we know that add func is just a function that lives there, right? So here we can move on to our next line of output. So we have our output right here, and it is assigned the evaluated result of add func, right? So we see in add func, we have two arguments passed in. And what we're going to do is we're going to pair our arguments to our parameters. So we have in our add func, maybe I should make a call stack very quickly. Okay. Ooh, these are not clean lines, but that's fine. So we're gonna add func. And now we can look into our local execution context right here. Okay. So in our local execution context, we have our parameters and arguments paired up. So we have num1, which in this case is 50, and num2, which in this case is 75. And we know that based on how they're paired up. So we know that this is the first one. So that must be num1. We have our second one, which must mean it's num2, okay? So what happens in our local execution context here is we are console logging num1 plus num2, which in this case would be 50 plus 75, and this is 125. Okay, I hope I did the math right. I think I did, yes. So it's 125. So what happens here is that it gets console logged here in this green box we have right here. So let me just go ahead and write it in green. So now we see 125, right? So that takes care of that. Although there is no return statement, that is the end of our function definition. Because there's no other lines there, there's nothing left to execute in our add func. We are all done with this function. If there were more lines of code, but there was a return, an early return statement, then we'd exit it. But in this case, there's only one line that needed to be executed, needs to be done. So that's all done. What we're gonna do now is that after we're completed, we're going to pop it off of our call stack, gonna garbage collect all of this, right? Now, before we move on, did anyone notice if anything was returned from here? Does our output have any value right now? Thumbs if it does, or thumbs down if it does not have a value. It does not have a value. So since we don't have anything returned, this is technically still undefined, right? So our output does not have a value. We just had something show up on the console log. So when we console log output, what are we going to see in our console? If anyone is so brave enough to volunteer, what would you actually see in this little green box here?
I often see undefined, or I might see a value pop up in there. I'm not really sure about why, you know, it would show up as undefined, or sometimes why it would show up with like the value from the function. But obviously I know it's not in global memory, but right. I do see undefined often pop up there.
Yeah, right. It's going to show up undefined because we didn't declare anything yet.
Yes, it will show up undefined. But not because we didn't declare anything. It does live in our global memory right now. Right now, we see that it is undefined based on what we have written here. Oopsie, that was the erase button. Based on what we see here, it will show up undefined. We did not return anything. There's nothing assigned to it. We're just console logging within the definition. So if we invoke it like we did here, if we invoke it, sure, we'll see 125, right? We'll see 125 based on this. But that does not change the value of output. This part might get a little tricky. Okay, so I'll walk through one more time. So here we have output invoked. Let me go ahead. Our output right here on our second line, const output, is set to the evaluated result of add func. So we're going to push onto our call stack add func one more time. And we're going to see our local execution context open up, and we're going to see our local memory exist, right? Our local memory, we were pairing our argument of 50 and 75 to a parameter of num1 and num2. So I'll just put n1 is 50 and n2 is 75, right? And inside of here, inside of our local execution context, what we're doing is adding these two numbers of 50 plus 75, right? And we are simply console logging it, right? We're just showing it on our console. We are not returning it. We're not assigning this value to the actual function itself. This is just what happens inside of it, okay? However, if this were to say something like, if this said return, if it said return num1 plus num2, then our output would have an actual value of 125. And then if we go as far as, and then once we hit this console log, then this would actually change from undefined to 125, okay? But that's based on the return keyword we have there. Since we do not have a return keyword here, it's just console logging, there is no actual assigned value to our output. It will just remain undefined. And here we will see undefined in our console. Okay, thumbs on that so far? Okay, awesome. Let me see if there's anything in the chat I might've missed. Awesome, okay, great. So this is how our console log works. It's different from our return because our console log will just show it on our console. Our return actually provides that value to our function. It is a returned value from our function. Okay,
I do think I see a question from Chris Parsons. I don't know if he feels like he answered it. It says the function has a return command. Why would we want to use a console log, a function that has a return command?
The function has a return command. Why would we want to console log a function that has a return command? So if I'm understanding your question correctly, Chris, and thank you, Eli, for pointing that out to me. Sorry, I might have missed it. Yes, like Pinzi said, it's important for debugging. So we want to console log throughout our function because we want to see if A, our function is working the way we want it to, and B, we want to see if we're moving through our function, if we're moving through it the way we want to. So let's say if we had a super long function that's not giving us an output, we could be blocked at some part of it. We could see that we're not entering some parts of it, or we can see that we're not getting our data the way we want it to, okay? So like Pinzi said, again, it's just really important to use. It's very helpful when it comes to debugging. All right, great question though. Okay, so now that we kind of have a whole, an understanding of functions, let's talk about something called objects, okay? So as we see here on our screen, we have an object, and objects can contain information in it. It could have functionality, and we could do something with information and functionality all in one giant object itself, okay? So if we take a look at this part, do I have something for us to walk through? Yes, I do. Okay, so if we look through this right here, we have our object named person, okay? We have an object labeled person, and I want to just quickly show that we know this is an object versus an array based on the brackets that we're using here, okay? So an array uses square brackets, an object uses curly brackets. Oops, that's not my eraser. Okay. So we have our object here, and inside of our object, we have things called key pair values, right? So we have right here, we have our key of name, and we have our value of this string will. So I'm going to erase it really quickly. I'll just use my pointer. So we have our key of name, and it's given a value of will, right? So what I want to highlight with our objects is that our keys would be everything on the left side of this colon. Our values is everything on the right side, okay? Our keys on the left side are name, company, fave num, has red hair, face max. Those are all keys. And these keys are all inherently strings, okay? And strings are basically just a data type of text. So these are all strings. So this would basically be the same thing if I wrote this in quotes. Name, company, fave num, all that good stuff. Those are all strings. And what's on the right side of it are our values. So we have our key pair values, and the values could be more than a string, as we see, right? So our key of name has a value string will, our key company has a value string Codesmith, our fave num is a numerical value of 17, has red hair is a Boolean value, which is a true or false value of true. And we could even go as far as giving a nested array, right? So our fave snacks could be an array of twin snakes and gummy bears. Yes, arrays are also a type of object. Yes, it's but they are objects as well.
So then my second question is, how do you clarify then an array, which is its own thing, from this other type of object, which has a key value pair? So another term that's more specific for that then, is that a dictionary maybe, or JavaScript? Python, they would call that that seems to look a lot like a dictionary, but
I'm not entirely sure if there's any other language or vocabulary out there that exists that you could differentiate between the two, other than what kind of properties live inside of them. So an array can have elements, and an object could have key value pairs. Arrays can have deeply nested objects, and objects can also have deeply nested arrays. It's just a matter of the language you use to describe them, really.
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries. All right, so in here, again, we have our fave snacks, which is a nested array of twin snakes. And if we wanted to go one step further than that, we could have something called, let's say, fave music, right? We could have another object in it with an artist, a title, and a year, right? We could do that. We could add more things to our fave music. So objects are super complex. You could have so many different things in there, but to keep it extra simple, this is what you can have inside of your objects. Okay, this is just the structure of it. Some other key things to remember about this is that we have these commas here. These commas highlight the differences between each of these key value pairs, right? So if we didn't have this comma right here, this would be one giant key value pair. But because we do have that comma here, this right here is one key pair value. This is another one, so on and so forth, okay? So there's lots of little bits and pieces to it, but this is pretty much how we make our objects, okay? Thumbs on that so far. Okay, do we have any questions on what our object has in it, how it looks, and how we've constructed it so far? Okay, so good, awesome.
So real quick, so you talked about if we were to remove the comma, it would just be one key value pair. So would the key be name in that case?
And yes. Then,
so would that then turn that into an array? Like what would...
So if we didn't have this comma here, there'd be a couple things that would happen. One, there would probably be a syntax error because we have this here. Two, we have this other syntax error right here. But if we were to just not look at that, if we just didn't have this here, what this would look like would just be name of company, name would be Will Company Codesmith. And then that would be the end of that.
Okay, so this would, it would just convert it into a string, essentially.
It wouldn't, like, there's no, like, type coercion here that happens. You'd probably just run into a bunch of syntax errors.
Sure, okay, that makes sense.
But, yeah, so just for, like, simplicity's sake, you have to make sure you put that comma there to differentiate between your key pair values.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so good question. That was a great question. So now let's kind of see how we access this object. Let's see how we use this object. Let's see how it comes into play for us, right? So underneath our object declaration, we have something called, we just want to access this object and check out if it has something called name in it, right? So in our global memory, I'm just going to rewrite this very quickly for everyone. We have our person, which is an object. It has a property name, I'm sorry, has a key name of Will, company of Codesmith. Probably should have wrote this out earlier for y'all. Fave num is 17, has red hair, is that Boolean? Of true, then fave snacks of twin snakes. I haven't heard Will talk about those in a while. I don't think he likes them anymore. And then gummy bears. Maybe he likes gummy bears more. Okay, so here's our object that we're looking at, and we want to access this object's name, right? So in order to access what lives in our object, we want to access what is in there. How we write it is we want to write the name of the object, which in this case is person, and we use something called the dot notation. All right, so let me just get another pink arrow going there, and I'll erase this tiny one. So this dot notation is basically telling JavaScript, like, hey, let's look inside of this object and let's see if this key of name exists. Right? So this is our dot notation. So what JavaScript does is like, okay, let's take a look. We have something called person in our global memory. Awesome. Let's access that. Let's go inside. Let's dig deeper. So it iterates through all of the key value pairs that exist in there. And thankfully, name does exist in there. It's our first key value pair. And we see that right here. So what comes out of here, oopsie, what comes out of here will just be the string will. Thumbs on that so far? Okay, so this dot notation allows us to access this object and find the exact key of name in there, and it will give us back the value that's associated with it. Okay. All right, so I'm gonna move on to the next one. Excuse me, so sorry. Okay, so next we have person, and then we have something called our bracket notation. This is another way to access our object. So we could access our object two ways, dot and bracket. Before I move on, Chris, yes. If you wanted to show up in your console, yes, you write console log dot person dot name. Yes. Great question though. So again, to use our bracket notation, we have person the same way that we did before. We're looking in our global memory. Does this object name person exist? And we're using our square brackets. And when we want to access this specific key, we have to wrap it in quotes, right? So we want to access fave num. So let's check our global memory. Does person exist? Yes, it does. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this arrow and we're going to see name. Nope, that doesn't match. Company, nope. Fave num, yes. Fave num matches. So what this will return for us would be the numeric value of 17. Okay. So if we were not to use the quotes around it, we wouldn't get the number 17 back. Okay. All right. So then next, let me see. So what comes after that is we want to now look at our person object again. Our next line, we want to look at their fave snacks at the zeroth index. So here we're using both the dot and bracket notation. Okay, so here, again, we're checking to see, does our person object exist in our global memory? Yes, it does. Great, let's go inside. Name, nope. Company, nope. Fave num, nope. Has red hair, nope, that's not it. Fave snacks, great. All right, so now we're at our fave snacks. And now we want to actually look for our zeroth index. Could have wrote this a little clearer, but here we are looking at our zeroth index of twin snakes. As we know, gummy bears would be our first index, so this is our zeroth index because arrays go zero up until wherever. So what this would essentially produce for us would be the string twin snakes. Okay, thumbs on that so far? Yes, all right, let me check the chat for any questions. Would you choose to use the brackets instead of the dot notation when you call more than one key of the object? If I wanna call more than one key of the object, there's a method you could use if you wanna access multiple keys. So I wouldn't necessarily say like you're tied down to using the bracket notation. But I will explain the difference between bracket and dot a little more afterwards. But if you want to access more than one key, there's a method you could use for that. And then, yes, Finzi, arrays are objects too. Yes, they are. So one thing just to quickly to note is that, again, when you're using the dot notation, let's see. If you were to use the dot notation, we cannot identify the key, we cannot access the key if the key starts with a numeric value. Okay, so let me just change this up a little bit more. So let's say we added another, let's say we added another one called, one, one name. I don't even know if that follows camel case. one property. Okay, we call it one prop, right? So if we wanted to access this key of one prop, and it'll be hello, then we wouldn't actually need, sorry, we wouldn't use dot notation. We would use bracket notation. Okay. And that's just the way that JavaScript works. So we'd have to access it like this. One prop. And then this would give us the string of hello. Okay. Now, if we had another key value pair, let's say if we had something like, again, going back to fave music, if we have something called fave music, where there is a noticeable space between the word fave and the word music. Let's say he's a huge fan of Beyonce, right? If we want to access it, we would also use bracket notation as opposed to dot notation, okay? So if we wanted to see, if we wanted to figure out how to access this string of Beyonce, we would write fave, I have to write it on the second line. Music, and then we get Beyonce out of it. Thumbs on that so far?
So basically you're saying the dot notation can only be used if you have a string of characters with no spaces?
A string of characters with no spaces? So if the key had no, If the key had no spaces in it, we can use dot notation.
Right. And you could have a number if it's a string in there.
Yes. Right? So let's say our key was, I don't know, prop one, like that, right? Then we could use dot notation. As long as the key does not begin with a number, you could use dot notation.
Could it begin
with the key doesn't have any spaces, you can use dot notation.
Right.
Yes. Okay.
And another question is, can you use this like bracket notation to go really deep into an object? So, you know, perhaps there might be another key value object inside of Fave Snack. So maybe twin snakes could be a key, and then it would have an array of values in there, you know, and then what if you wanted to go deeper and deeper and deeper and you had a really, really, really deep, you know, sort of thing, you know what I mean?
We'd do super deeply nested.
Yeah. Another nested object key, right? And another nested key object key, right? Is there a best coding practice?
At that point, you would have to write a function to search inside of your deeply nested object. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how, you could probably use bracket notation. It would just be a bunch of different brackets next to each other, but you could also just use a function to access or a method to access something deeply nested like that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, no worries. Okay, let me just check the chat one more time. Okay, sweet. All right, so thumbs on how this works so far. Are we following? Awesome, okay. So, lastly, before we wrap up, I just want to go over how we can store functionality in an object. So again, objects are really amazing things. We could do all sorts of things with it. And on top of having accessible key value pairs, we can also have methods or functions nested inside of this, right? So, okay. I didn't prepare an extra slide for this, but basically what's happening here is inside of our person object, again, this is Will. He has a company of Codesmith, Fave Num and all that stuff. And underneath his Fave Snacks, we have this functionality, right? And this functionality is what we call a method, right? So this functionality is an anonymous function because there's no specified label for it. But what happens is when we want to access this, when we access this greeting, we will log to our console, hello, everybody. Okay. So here underneath it, we have person.name and we know how that works. We know that's going to give us, this is going to give us Will. But once we go into person.greeting, this would print on our console in our green box over here. This would print the string, hello, oopsie, everybody. Okay, that would come out in our console. Thumbs on that so far? Awesome. Okay. So that is just pretty much a method on our object. Okay, so to kind of wrap everything up, let me make sure I didn't miss anything in the chat. Okay,
to kind of wrap. Can I ask you a quick question on this?
Yeah.
So let's say that we have a global variable and we declare mm-hmm. it as output equals person.greeting, invoking the function.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's say instead of console.log, we had a return statement instead. And the mm-hmm. return statement was hello, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And we ran, and then we looked at what output is. Would output get the value of hello, everybody, if it was a returned inside that function?
Yes.
Does it push into global memory?
Does it push into global memory? It would be assigned to output in global memory, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Awesome. That was a very good question. Very inquisitive. I like that. But yeah, so that is pretty much everything to cover for tonight. So just to kind of summarize, here we have functions to prevent code duplication and repeating ourselves, meaning to avoid breaking the dry rule. We can wrap code in a function and store it in memory to reuse, kind of the way that we had to pass in parameters and arguments and match those together. We went over execution context. Meaning whenever we invoke our function, this diagram of our local execution context opens up. We see what's stored in global memory and our local memory and how those kind of work out for us, what gets pushed, what gets stored, all that good stuff. We took a look at objects. We saw what made up key value pairs. We saw that keys were strings and values are any kind of data type. As we saw, we had numbers, we had arrays, we had strings and all that good stuff. We could also have methods or functions stored in our object. And we have object looping. We have object looping where you can iterate over your loop. You could iterate over your key pair as we saw as we were moving up and down our object. So we're moving up and down it based on how we accessed it there. Okay, so that concludes tonight's workshop, everyone. Thank you all so much for sticking with me. I felt like I talked forever. I probably ran out of water already. So what's next? So as you all know, this is one of our beginner workshops. Thank you all so much for coming and staying. I appreciate it. This is one of our beginner workshops. If you're super interested in learning more, we have variable controls, flow and looping. We also have our intros. And there's also JavaScript hard parts for you all to attend. I really loved going to the closure and recursion one a lot. Our instructors that go over it, the people that lead those workshops are really amazing at explaining things and breaking it down. So if you ever are very curious about it, and if you're interested in getting into Codesmith, those are great ways to kind of get your feet wet with it. And if you're one step ahead of that, asynchronous JavaScript is a really fun one. So please come out to these workshops, of course. I would love to see you all again soon. And if you're not interested in workshops, that's totally fine. You could continue learning through our CSX platform, where it's just comprehensive challenges and prompts that get you through these concepts of JavaScript. Okay. So yeah, I hope everyone had a great night. I hope everyone walked away and learned something tonight. But other than that, I'm going to go and end the meeting tonight now, all right? I'll see everyone next time. Good night.